Hello, welcome to the Self-Learning Podcast by Dr. Sushma Singh. Let us start discussion on Unit 19, State Power as elaborated by Marx, Weber, Parsons and others. Our topic is the concept of power. Although power is a universal phenomenon in human activities and social relationships, there is no uniform conceptualization of this concept. It is highly abstract and overlearned concept, deeply embedded in human society and culture. Though the vast literature in social science on power is scattered and heterogeneous, the concept has been discussed in these literatures on a conceptual framework based around power as characteristic of individual, power as interpersonal construct, power as commodity, power as casual construct, and power as philosophical construct. Each framework illustrates unique dimensions of the concept of power. The concept of power is often expressed in this literature as the ability to bring about the outcomes as one desire. The social significance of the exercise of power is that it limits the range of choice open to individuals. Sociologists often distinguish between two forms of power, authority and coercion. This unit concentrates in elaborating power in relation to state and society. Now let us move to the next point, Marx on power. Marx does not give a clear definition of power. For him, power means coercion. Marx views power to be held by a particular group in society at the expense of the rest of the society. According to him, the source of power in society lies in economic infrastructure and those who own the modes of production, that is, the dominant group, uses power to further its own interest and there by exploiting those who subject to power. Marx argues that although from time to time dominant classes do not have to resort to naked force to maintain their power and supremacy, the absence of such obvious coercion should not be taken to signify an absence of exploitation. A lack of naked oppression does not indicate lack of oppression and the lack of any need of force. Lack of naked oppression does not mean that the domination is not taking place. It is only that the dominated are unaware of their condition because of the effectiveness of the ideologies into which they have been socialized. How do such dominant ideas, which hails the dominating power of the dominant class and the exploitation of the subordinate class, gain such general acceptance? Marxists argue that the particular ideas come to prevail through various key agencies of socialization. Institutions like the family, education systems and the mass media play a crucial role in promoting generally held beliefs and values. For Marxists, through these institutions of socialization, the real character of the class society is justified, and thus it ensures social inequality and domination, and thereby the acceptance of the power structure in the society. This is the key element of the Marxist approach to the superstructure. A society's non-economic institutions and the ideas and beliefs they promote. The assumption is that they exist to prop up a class-based mode of production. Thus, the power inequality in the economic infrastructure is reflected in the superstructure. Now, let us move to the next point, dominance and subordination. Marxist theorists argue that institutions like education, state and mass media justify the stereotypical images of superiority and inferiority coinciding with the class position. Thus, in terms of Marxian theory, the relationship of dominance and subordination in the infrastructure is justified and legalized by the superstructure. For example, in capitalist society, the unequal relationship between employees and employers will be reflected and legitimated in the legal system. A range of legal status protect the rights of property owners and in particular their right to a disproportionate share of the wealth produced by their employees. Marxists argue that such an analysis of the relationship between the infrastructure and superstructure tells in great deal about power in a class society. That means, for example, in capitalist society, the infrastructure produces particular kind of state, education system, family structure, etc. All institutions of superstructure that reflect the domination of class structure reinforce the power and privilege of the ruling class in the society. Marx views power as to be held by a particular group or dominant class in society at the expense of the rest of the society or subordinate class. This is a constant sum concept of power, since a net gain in the power of the dominant group represents a net loss in the power of the next society. The dominant group uses power to further its own interest, and these interests are in direct conflict with the interest of their subject to its power. For Marx, the source of power in society lies in the economic infrastructure. The basis of dominance or power is the ownership of forces of production. The ruling class, those who own the forces of production, use power to exploit and oppress the subject class in all societies. The case of power to exploit others is defined by Marx as coercion. It is seen as an illegitimate use of power, since it forces the subject class to submit to a situation which is against its interest. The only way to return power to the people is communal ownership of the forces of production. Since everyone will now share the same relationship to the forces of production, power will be shared by all members of society. Here, Marx's concepts of false consciousness and class consciousness are of importance. When the subordinate class subscribe to dominant ideologies which obscure the real nature of class society from their gaze, their picture of world and their place in it is false. When the exploited class realizes their exploited status and start recognizing themselves to belonging to the same class, there originates class consciousness among them. In their subjective view of themselves and their condition comes to match its objective reality. It is the emergence of a class consciousness by a subordinate class that is the key which unlocks the revolution, which overthrows the existing power structure of the society to replace it with one which suits to the new economic arrangements. Now let us wind up the session and take rest. Thank you very much for engaging yourself with the self-learning podcast.